Welcome to it. This is the Saturday morning wake-up call right here on KFAR. This is a show that is made possible entirely by the good folks over there at Far North Tactical and Bighorn Enterprises. Good morning. Sitting across from me here in the studio from Far North Tactical, we have Aaron Bennett.
Good morning, Steve.
There we go. We got you on the mic. And from Bighorn Enterprises, it's Josh Bennett. Good morning, Josh.
Good morning, Steve.
I am just the monkey behind the machine here. My point here is to make sure that you get your message out on the airwaves. And so I've done my job. Now that the border's hot, I'm just going to walk away. How's that sound?
Good.
All right. What's on your mind today?
I knew something good would happen.
Wow. Go. What the heck? We got a pretty...
Monkey got your tongue over there?
We got a pretty cool... not going to say a lot about it. We got a pretty cool email from a soldier in Afghanistan who's been listening online after, well, after, I guess, when we post them, so he's listening on YouTube. Anyways, he just wrote an email, thanked us for the show, and had a few things to say I'm not really going to go into, but anyways, he knows who he is, so thanks for the email, and hope you get home soon. We'll be praying for that one. Hopefully they'll get it over with and let you come home where you belong.
I thought we've already ended a decade of war. Isn't that what President Obama said in his victory speech?
Was that a
couple weeks ago? We've ended a decade of war.
Well, sure, you end a decade, but then you start a new
one. Oh, is that one?
Yeah.
I thought the wars were over.
Fresh decades.
Right. You got to take them, you know, 10 at a time.
So the 100 years war, that was just 10 decades?
One of the things he said that was, I think, fine to say was... He had heard us, I think, last week or 2 weeks ago when we asked, are you better off today than you were 4 years ago? I think that was last week when we were talking about Obama being reelected. And he said, I can definitely say I'm not because I was in New Mexico 4 years ago. Now I'm in Afghanistan. That sucks. Anyways,
yeah, but didn't,
appreciate
isn't
it.
That kind of our whole point? Not to bash on him at all. It was a great email. I got to hear it, too. But that's the whole point. He chose to go in the military and do things of that nature, but it all comes down to the individual. I mean, to a point anyway. So if you're not letting politics affect your everyday life, you can be better off. I mean, I'm a lot better off than I was 4 years ago. It's like I pointed out last week, 4 years ago was pretty mid-stride in the housing bubble, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I do is build buildings forever, so... I had to change industries for the better, I think, and get into doing trucking and all that, so.
No, one could argue, though, and we've talked about it before on this program, that realistically, the folks that enter the Army don't have a lot of other options out there. It's not that they're volunteering out of a sense of patriotism and love of country.
Some of them do. I think some of them don't. Like we said, some of them, it's a job or...
Almost like a selective graft, in a sense. It's an economic graft.
Sometimes I think it's an act of... You know, they don't know what to... What else do you do? At least they get a job and a...
Signing bonus.
And a meal and stuff.
Three hots and a cot.
I think we're
you
seeing...
You can get
a,
that in jail.
You could. And you know what? That is a valid option for some people.
And we've known people that do that. Especially when winter rolls around. Wow. Anyways, it's... I think he and I think a lot of soldiers over there are tired of it too. Just as much as... Other people, they want to come home, you know.
Not to mention they go over there and, you know, high ideals of doing something good. I don't think hardly anybody joins the military hoping to do something horrible, you know, especially being an American.
Right, fighting for liberty, fighting for freedom in America, sure.
The delusion rolls away pretty quick once you get over there, and then you hear about all the stuff at home, the NDAA and things of that nature. So what are you fighting to secure? A stronger central government?
Yeah, that's pretty interesting. That's a really good point. So you're over there fighting, and you see back home at your homeland, you got your Patriot Act, your NDAA, which the NDAA is a ramped-up Patriot Act, basically.
You know, technically, the NDAA is just simply the authorization for the spending of and these measures that got wrapped up into it, because the NDAA is something that rolls around every year.
But... It was Sections 1021 and 1022 don't normally pop up in those, and those are law now. So, and it's pretty disappointing when all these guys, I think even, what's our bonehead congressman's name?
Don Young?
Been there for
50 years?
Yeah,
young.
I know for a fact that Frank Turney called him out on that, and when it came back up for a vote to vote those two sections out, pretty sure he voted to keep them in. In fact, I think the majority of the Republicans did. I know the Democrats did too, just because, you know, we got to be safe from those Americans.
All right, so you go over and, I mean, you, at the recruiting office, you get told that you're this entity for liberty, and you go over there and find out you're fighting for interests. You even get told that once you get there, and you see that in your press releases, mm-hmm. that you're fighting for interests. Nobody really knows what those interests are, but they're definitely not liberty at home. Well, you become pretty disillusioned pretty quick. I mean, we have the highest suicide rate ever in our military, and nobody's looking at the cause. They're just looking at the end result. There's a reason that they're becoming disillusioned, disgruntled, and even depressed.
Yeah. When I was in Bosnia, we had a pretty high suicide rate there, and that was, you know, even before the stuff at home in terms of the lack of freedoms. We just the job that we had was one of those things that, hey, we don't train for this. The job of the Army is to go in there and kill people and break stuff, you know? And mm-hmm. we're over there nation building. We were doing that in Bosnia, you know, 16, 17 years ago. And you look at what we're doing now in Afghanistan and Iraq. Who are we fighting? Are we fighting?
I don't think they know who they're fighting. I think the biggest reason is, why are they fighting?
Why are they there in the first place?
I don't know. I just wish they'd get it over with. Let them come home. I mean, the politicians, get it over with. Let them come home.
Well, they got to start a new war to end that one.
That's true. They're working on it, I'm sure.
If Iran would just hurry up and let us attack them.
If we could just come up with that good false flag. Like, where are all the good false flag people?
Well, right now we've got aircraft.
They used them all up on WMDs.
Right now we've got aircraft carriers, of the, what do we have, seven?
Seven, I think there are five of them.
There are five of them right now deployed, and three or four of them are actually in the Middle East, which is unprecedented. Absolutely unprecedented right now in terms of our ramp up. We've got troops that are forward deployed in more countries right now in the Middle East than we've ever had. We're definitely prepared for something over there, and whether it's Syria or Iran or Israel even at this point. I mean, you look right now at what's going on this week in Israel and how the whole world is like, oh, there goes Israel again, oppressing those Palestinians. Wait, who's firing rockets at whom? Oh, and why is it our job to go in there and...
Yeah, we don't need to be bothered by that. They can take care of themselves, both sides. I don't think it's very... Is it really that smart to have all your forces gathered together in one such a concentrated spot? I mean, if I was a real bad guy and I was like, Vladimir Putin, and I'd press a button, half your forces are gone in 3 seconds. Anyway, I don't want to digress into crap, but... I just wanted to say something about the soldier right in us. We appreciated that, and I hope he keeps his head down and gets home safe sooner than later. You want to move on?
Sure.
Talk about the Wild Wild West show on Wednesday?
Yeah, that'd be nice.
Go ahead. Did you listen?
Yeah, I listened.
Okay.
I listened to... I guess what I gathered from it is that the FBI approached...
Michael.
Wasn't the other way around.
Right. That's true.
Sutherland, who I've got to know a little bit, and unfortunately Josh has too, approached Micheal Dukes to come on his show with the prosecutor in the Schaefer-Cox case.
Strachey. I don't remember what his name was.
I try not to remember. Anyway, they approached Dukes and asked to come on his show to talk to people in the greater Fairbanks area, kind of alleviate some delusions or whatever else they may have had about the case and this and that, which is pretty interesting that, I mean, how often does that happen that the FBI volunteers himself up to come on a radio show?
It's for not... public relations of all things.
Right.
Like they're worried about what the people of Fairbanks think about the office of the FBI right now.
Sure.
Yeah, right.
It's pretty interesting to listen to the show. Josh called in, heard a couple other calls. some of the interesting things that I took from it is that
they lied.
First and foremost, they lied. I was on the air trying really hard to, or I mean, I was on the phone line trying really hard to get through. Josh brought up one of the main points I was going to bring up is they started it out by saying that they weren't, you know, really pursuing Cox or the whole ideology there.
Proactive.
Until they're, from what I gather, they were talking about the militia summit meeting in February or whatever they all went to. And so on and so forth. They were looking for dummy grenades and whatnot. But I really wanted to get through the line, mainly because I was there at that militia summit meeting, because their main guy, main boot on the ground, who they try and sweep under the rug all the time because he was such a doofus, was William Fulton. And I was there in the hotel room when that whole... The reason that I didn't get caught up in their scammy scam is because I got up and walked out of the room because I was so alarmed. And what, I mean, I'm just going to come flat out and say it. William Fulton hatched the whole plan to try and force grenades on those guys. They didn't even have that in their mind. Because William approached me about it and said, look, here's what I'm going to do. He's like, we're going to make a bunch of, he knows I own a store. We traded with each other all the time. I helped him set up his store. He supported my store. We're really good friends. And he hatched that whole plan there in the hotel room and tried to get me involved with it. You know, just, we're good buddies. You got to help me out with this, this and that. And he approached them with this idea of buying this case lot of 50 dummy grenades and, you know, this plan to get all the stuff they needed to turn them into real ones. And they never actually bought real grenades from him. They just bought dummy grenades.
Right, but they got them with, what, for intent?
I guess.
Even though they didn't have the means to do.
But the interesting part is it's two-point thing here. The FBI was making the claim that they weren't interested in Schaefer Cox until that time.
Happened.
But they already had Bill Fulton on their employ. They're at that militia summit meeting, which, by the way, Bill Fulton set that up, whole meeting.
What, about 8 months later?
I'm going to get there.
Okay, get there. Come on.
So Fulton's there, already under the employ of the FBI, pushing this ideology of buying weapons outside the box, right? Fulton sets himself up to them as this go-to guy to get things that they need outside the box, right? So without that waypoint, they had no access to anything, you know, down that line of thinking, right?
Yeah.
So for them to say that they weren't interested in him, but they'd already previously employed this guy to go and push this plan off on them and set up this big meeting to bring everybody there, is just ridiculous. But the reason I wanted to call in so bad is 8 months before that.
Roger that.
At my store, Far North Tactical, I threw an event there that was for the Alaska Conservative Coalition.
IACC, yep. It was a fundraiser.
It was a fundraiser, right, that I invited William Fulton to. And Fulton spent most of his time the first day with Schaefer Cox at Pike's Landing. And they hatched this plan and this and that. And Fulton came to me and told me about it and so on and so forth, which I ended up foiling without... I didn't realize that Fulton was working for the FBI, but I ended up foiling that plan because I was just so alarmed by its... audacity that I invited, you know, a bunch of guys to my store that were respectable in this town, people I knew that Schaefer respected and so on and so forth, and called Schaefer out to task on it. And hey, look at this crazy thing that he's trying to do. And what ultimately ended up coming out is Schaefer's like, well, that wasn't my plan. Bill pushed that whole thing. I don't even know what you guys are talking about. So long story short, when all of the when everything got uncovered, ultimately what came to light is that Bill Fulton was working for the FBI 8 months before Sutherland said that they were.
Well, before Sutherland said
said that they were interested in Schaefer Cox.
But they were concerned.
Right. They already had Fulton up here trying to push. And here was the plan that Fulton had. And let me repeat. Here's the plan that Fulton had.
I wonder who gave him that plan.
I don't know. The plan was to kidnap judges in this area and hold them for trial, and ultimately, when the trial was over, hang them. That was the plan that Fulton laid out to everybody. And, of course...
That didn't come from Schaefer Cox?
You know, Schaefer Cox never laid that plan out. In hindsight, 2020, of course, Schaefer was drawing a blank the whole time.
What was the druggie? The guy that's got like 50 felonies that they hired.
That's it?
Olson?
J.R. Olson.
J.R. Olson. Yeah. I've read the transcripts of the whole, because I brought it up, and I heard other people ask about it, and they're like, oh, no, Schaefer's the one that brought up the whole 241 thing. That's bull crap. Olson did. He was the first one to use the word, and he was the one that brought up the plan, and... I'm telling you, I've read the FBI transcripts when they did the recordings, and those guys there said, you're a nut job. We're not going to do that.
Ultimately, they did get on board with the 241 ideology, but it wasn't instigated by them. It's just like they got on board with buying silencers and dummy grenades, but it wasn't brought up by them. I know for a fact that it wasn't brought up by them. I was sitting in the freaking room when Fulton hatched the whole plan to supply him with these things. You know, Fulton was the contact for them to get the things that Olson brought him.
Yeah, right.
Ultimately, they thought that Fulton was the supplier for those things. But Fulton pushed that plan. He pushed that plan in February.
What's the timeline? February of 11?
11. And it was 8 months prior to that. July of 10, that Fulton was in the employ of the FBI with the charge to get something on Schaefer Cox.
Yeah, and we're not saying that he didn't do some dumb things and all this and that, but to have the FBI, the point is the FBI got on the radio or whatever and acted like, oh, we're just walking along and all of a sudden these crazy guys jumped out of the woods and luckily we were there to stop them. Bull crap, you guys are pushing the whole thing. I brought that up to him when I got through. Look at how many times they've had these foiled terror plots in the last few months. All of them have been instigated by the FBI. The FBI goes around, literally, to different areas, finds troublemakers, or maybe not troublemakers, but just lost souls or whatever, and they get someone to befriend them, and they start talking a little bit and a little bit more. What do you usually do? Okay, just anyone. If you're lonely or whatever, or you're already upset about something, maybe you're not even lonely. You get some guy, you get to trust him, you get to be friends, and all of a sudden he's got a problem. And so now you're starting to listen to him. And I'm not saying that it's right that eventually you decide to go blow something up. Of course it's not.
Right.
Never had the thought in the first place. They brought the thought to you, and then they bring you the weapons, and they're always dummy weapons. I mean, we saw it with Randy. I'm glad that you brought up the anarchists, that they stomped and foiled the plot for the anarchists to blow up the building or the bridge or whatever. Those guys never had an intention to do anything. They brought in the bombs and said, oh, here's your target, let's go do it. Then they stop it. The guy that was going to blow up the Fed bank in New York, total FBI plot from day one. They find some guy from the Middle East, and they get to be his friend, and then they get him mad, and then they, here's the weapons, and then they foil it, and then they go, praise us. Oh, look at us. We saved you again.
Take any political activist out there that is out there hitting the ballot box or whatever else, and then, you know, how disgruntled is your typical voter going
to
be?
Look at the guy that was out in King Salmon, who was a recent convert to Islam. He had no intentions for nothing. The FBI gets someone out there to start befriending him. I mean, this is King Salmon. There's not a whole lot to do out there but catch fish in the summertime and sleep during the winter. I've been out there 5 years. I was out there.
Really? Were you out there befriending him?
I was out there for the FBI.
Boy.
No. So this guy gets to talking to him, and then all of a sudden they start talking about the Palestinian cause and gets this guy mad and blah, 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 and he's upset. This goes on for a year or 2 years or whatever, and he flies to Anchorage. You know, he convinces them to maybe do a bombing plot or maybe do something. So he flies to Anchorage. I think he flew to Anchorage to visit with his wife because he was distressed, wanted to talk to her about it. She was traveling. And they pick him up and land him in jail for terrorism. And I read a pretty long article about him and what his wife said. She said, this was a set-up plot. My husband wasn't planning on doing anything. But then they get to jump up and down, get on the news that they saved us from another terrorist plot. So it makes you wonder, are they behind all of them?
Well, name one that they're not.
I don't know. Can they name one that they're not? I mean, the ones that happened, is it something that they did and it got messed up and they didn't stop it in time? I don't know. That's getting down the conspiracy theory, but it sure is awful weird that keeps happening over and over and over, and each time it happens that they stop it, it happens to be that they started it in the first place. I never heard of this stuff at all over, what, before 9/11. Never heard about this kind of stuff. Now it happens all the time, and it's always the FBI? I mean, I don't know. I'm just throwing that out there.
Well, the FBI... I can't remember what source you go to, but they released the thing saying they employed 20,000 more informants. And that's a lot of people out there actively trying to find people to do something wrong, or even creating things to do something wrong. And you can't tell me they don't create it. I've been a part of it. I've had to sit there and watch it go on right in front of me. And, you know, I unwittingly foiled their first plot, you know, in July of 10 without even meaning to. I didn't know that... there was a big old FBI plot going on. I was just alarmed at the plan that was unfolding in front of me and got a bunch of guys together. You know, like, I guess I could have ran to the cops or something, but, you know, you don't have a lot, you don't have a case to give them. You know, if you've ever dealt with the police, you got to have something solid. So other than Bill just flapping his soup coolers, I wasn't too, you know, I didn't have much of a story to go by. So I got a bunch of older men that I figured, and not all older men, but a lot of people that I thought Schaefer would respect, brought them all together. When everything comes down and when it all comes out in the wash, it was Fulton's plan from the beginning. And then the FBI comes on the radio and says that they weren't even interested in Schaefer until he was after grenades in February of 11.
Right.
Croc. Almost a year later. What a bunch of crap.
Croc crap. Liars. Yeah, this whole thing where they came on and said that they're not interested in militias.
Josh just said it. They're liars.
Yeah.
They came on Duke's show to lie.
I think they came on Duke's show to get people complacent again, not worried about them.
Sure.
There's really nothing new under the sun, though. I mean, you think about it, this whole idea of police informants, you see that all the time in terms of any kind of statist society.
Oh, yeah.
You look at the Soviet Union. The Nazis. I mean, there's going to be government informants. There's going to be your neighbors ready to turn you in for suspicious activity. We even have, I mean, the campaign going on right now. If you see something, say something.
Yeah.
They're running ads encouraging people to turn in their neighbors for suspicious activity. You know, is it surprising to you that the FBI would be out there trying to
No, we just don't
round
want people
up
to get the wrong impression from those guys that they were trying to do some public relations thing to get people to think that they're not bad guys, because they are bad guys. They're not nice. They have a history of shooting kids in the back and wives in the face, holding babies. I mean, that's just the truth.
Oh, you got to bring up Randy Reaver.
Well, it's the truth. And they burned, what,
well, that was U.S. Marshals. Is that the FBI?
I'm pretty sure they worked together.
Oh, no.
Yeah. And I'm not saying that Sutherland shot anyone like that. I'm saying that the agency itself is not... I don't trust them at all. Unfortunately, it'd be nice to think that they're there to protect...
Global Force for Good.
to protect the citizens' liberties. But I don't really see that happening when they're out... It seems to me that they're out trying to get citizens put in jail. I mean, just throwing that out there. And, you know, I asked him specifically about when he came to my house. You know, I didn't say my name, so maybe he didn't realize it was me calling. But I said, you know, why didn't you just show a warrant when you're asked? I mean, you were asked specifically, do you have a warrant to enter my house? And you just said, you know, he goes, well, you know, that we looked at that situation. And under that specific situation for Michael Anderson and the specific home we had to go to, we felt like that we did the right way. Okay, totally circumvented the question of why didn't you show a warrant. Never brought that up. Never said anything about it. And then he said, you know, the homeowner was very... We knew there was children and a wife there, and the homeowner was very cooperative and blah, blah, blah. Yeah, no duh. I was cooperative. You showed up with a bunch of thugs with machine guns, surrounded our house, and came to the door with...
But
Michael
Josh,
Anderson.
They let the two that came inside left their machine guns outside.
Yeah, they only had their sidearms on and their body armor, and they had Michael Anderson's wife in front of them as basically a hostage. If you looked at it any other way besides the FBI, they were holding her in front of them, basically as a
Operation
shield.
Human Shield.
Aha! You know, the thing that we badmouth the Iraqis for. Then they come in. Yeah, I let them in because they said, Mr. Bennett, I don't want to scare your children. Get out of the way. Okay, that's pretty much a threat, so...
Well, I don't know why they would do that when they already had the house surrounded.
This is our
way. Yeah. You were there, weren't you?
All right, we got to take a break here for the Fox News. You've got it on the Saturday Morning Wake-Up Call. Welcome back to the Saturday Morning Wake-Up Call right here on KFAR. It's local talk radio, but we are streaming live around the world at KFAR660.com. And you can find us on your smartphone. If your phone is smart, it'll have the free radio app called TuneIn Radio. You can check it out for yourself. Download it for free and be listening to us on your phone. You can also listen to the archived shows on the website, KFAR660.com. Joining us from Bighorn Enterprises, Josh Bennett is in the studio. What happened to Aaron Bennett? Did he get abducted by the FBI during the frame?
He did. Went outside and never came back.
Didn't come back. All right. So we got Josh Bennett here. Josh, we got all four of our lines on hold right now. What do you want to do with them?
Well, since we only got an hour, let's take some calls. But guys, try to keep it quick, to the point, and we'll blow through them.
458-TALK is the number. Good morning, call. You're on. Yeah.
That's the kind of call I'm talking about.
Got it?
Hey, who is this?
This is Hillbilly.
Hillbilly, what's on your mind?
I'll keep it quick. I just wanted to say the most significant thing about the show on Wednesday was that the FBI agent made the statement that all of us are right now paid stooges. Every one of us is a paid pigeon. According to the law, he said, if you see a crime, and that means including somebody conspiring to commit one, if you see a crime and don't turn them in, that in and of itself is a felony. So now all they got to do is have their FBI agent cozy up to you and say, I'm going to kill the president. And then if you don't turn him in, you're in on his conspiracy.
Huh.
That's all the way down to anything. If you see a crime, any crime, and you don't turn them in, it can be a misdemeanor, it can be somebody running a red light, and if they want to then turn around and take you to jail, they can take you to jail because you didn't turn them in.
Yep.
What do you think of that?
That's fantastic.
I'll listen off the air.
I think it's been that way actually for some time. They're just ramping up their application of that. I mean, and that's not something where we can say, oh, look at the FBI overstepping their bounds. Look at the legislature thinking that they can create laws out of thin air.
They can.
They do. They are.
That was one of the interesting things that the prosecutor said. A guy called in. I can't remember what he was asking about, but the prosecutor was like,
he was saying that you don't have to obey unconstitutional laws, and the prosecutor said, well, if Congress passed the law, then it's constitutional, and if you want it changed, you need to go through the process to
right,
get
I mean,
the law changed and blah, blah, blah.
But that totally flies in the face of the Nuremberg trials. You can't use the defense if I was just following orders.
Well, sure you can, because our system, we're all, you have this whole set of people that are looking for limited government. Limited government under a system that creates law. It doesn't work. The idea that that's ever going to happen is just ludicrous.
I've been reading that book that you gave me, Josh, about ancient Rome and what it means to you. And this is Roman law.
Yeah.
That idea that somehow Caesar can just create law, and it doesn't
or
have
Senate.
Yeah, you know, it doesn't have to have any kind of root in reality or common law or any, you could go ahead and make a law and make the river flow backwards if you want to.
Yeah, and the whole point with unconstitutional laws didn't have anything to do with whether Congress, whether the court, whether anyone says it is or not. If it's against common law, it's unconstitutional. If it's not set inside the bounds of the Constitution, I mean, look at all the things that they've said are constitutional. And I would say baloney to 99.99999% of them.
Okay.
Well, the Supreme Court
they're not bound by them is the point. It doesn't matter what they say. The whole point of not being bound by an unconstitutional law is you are not bound, not whether they decide they're bound or say that you're bound.
Yeah, during the...
Now, they can kill you for it. That's the other point, but...
The 1860s, they decided it was unconstitutional to secede from the Union.
Yep.
Even though all those states had in their constitutions that they could secede and only signed under the knowledge that if at any point they wanted
I thought
to
it was only Texas that had that in their constitution.
Well, yeah, Texas came along quite a ways later.
Here's
Virginia was the first one.
That kind of brings it where I wanted to take it with
you. Really?
Yeah, well, Dukes had these FBI guys on his show, which they did approach him, but he's a big states' rights guy. I mean, I've been listening to Dukes for four years, probably.
10th Amendment.
He's big on the states' rights. I mean, he was heavily behind the Firearms Freedom Act and things like that. He definitely believes in states' rights, you know, as a block to the Fed in general. And here you have the FBI comes on his show, and he had guys call in and say, well, the state dropped everything. And the state determined that you guys got all this stuff unconstitutionally, right, illegally. And the FBI guy wrote that all off by saying, well, you know, we're the Fed. We don't have to follow any of those rules.
Our judge said we were okay.
Right.
That was their answer to everything. It was, well, you know, a judge looked at all that and he said it was okay. Well, you know, that was brought up by the defense and the judge said it was okay.
Right, so...
Of course, they're both getting their same paycheck from the same people, the judge, the prosecutor, and the FBI agent. So it's pretty hard to believe that they all said it was okay.
So the federal government comes in here...
And I like, before you go to that one, to this okay thing, the Constitution says, and one of the things in the Declaration of Independence, one of the deals I was going to say the Pilgrims, the colonists were upset about, and this was something that they had talked about a lot. He takes us to foreign places to try us. That was one of their main deals, was that...
One of their main grievances in their Declaration of Independence.
Right. The king was taking them to unknown places, foreign jurisdictions, to try them, instead of trying them at their home, to be tried by their peers. Now, someone brought that up, rightfully so, to the FBI, and they said, well, you know, security, and, well, they never really had a good answer to that. But that was absolutely unconstitutional and absolutely wrong. He should have been tried right here in Fairbanks and tried by his peers. And his peers are, we've gone through this over and over, people that knew him. Those are the people that should have tried him. Anything else...
But you can't get a fair trial, Josh, if people know you.
Right. The state can't, supposedly. But that's the whole point, is not to be found guilty by the state. And, of course, they said, well, you know, the judge looked at that, and he decided it was okay to take it. Right. So go back to, well, you know, when the courts decide what's constitutional or not, no, it's just another man violating his oath and violating the Constitution. That was a violation of Schaefer Cox's rights, to be drug out of where the crime was committed, where he was from, and taken to foreign jurisdiction.
Now, I just want to make sure. Are you guys fans of Schaefer Cox?
Nope.
I mean, have you been supporters of Schaefer Cox over the years? Were you involved in his so-called militia?
Nope. I met him one time, but... I don't care who it is, if their rights are violated, it needs to be spoken out against. He, from what I can tell, had said some stupid things, and he did some stupid things, and if I saw him now, I'd call him out on it. In fact, the one time I met him, I told him he was an idiot. By the time our conversation ended, it was kind of joking. I said, well, you're an idiot. But still, that doesn't change the fact, right off the bat, they didn't get the correct warrants to do the stuff that they did. They drug him to a foreign jurisdiction, and they can't say, well, it wasn't really a foreign jurisdiction because we're the Fed, so, you know, anything inside the United States is not a foreign jurisdiction. Bull crap. The whole deal about that was he should have been tried right here in Fairbanks, Alaska, from people that knew him. End of story. And if he got off, too bad, state. And if we found him guilty...
When the state dropped all the charges and they petitioned the Fed to drop all the charges, what did they fall back on as their claim to be able to go ahead and try him?
Patriot Act.
The Patriot Act. So in other words, the Patriot Act
gave them the right to do things without following the Fourth Amendment.
Well, any of the amendments.
Any of them,
think
right.
About it, yeah.
But the Fourth Amendment was what was really brought up. That's why they got to come into my house, supposedly without a warrant, because the Patriot Act gives them the right to do things without warrants anymore.
If you just base it on that, people should be a little bit alarmed, you know? They come on the radio to give themselves some credence, this and that, but long story short, the whole trial, from beginning to end, says that they don't have to follow anything constitutional. And they come on here and talk about how, you know, they love the Constitution, not really after anybody that just is a...
They're for free speech.
Yeah.
Bull. And, yeah, bull. They're liars. So this whole thing where they like militias and they want you to join militias and have your free speech... I wouldn't go out and join a militia and let them know that you're in one. I just stay.
Well, what about the
shut up?
The secession, the petition right now to secede from the union. Would that be an expression of free speech? Would that be a good idea? I mean, you've got all these people talking about.
Well, you look at the last.
I don't sign nothing because the last time we had a secession idea, the 750,000 people were killed.
Or you could say, "Where's Joe?"
I mean, Joe Vogler. Yeah.
Bump.
He was a secessionist.
Bump.
He was actually an independent. He wanted to Alaska to be an independent entity long. Even before statehood, he felt that statehood itself was foisted upon the people of Alaska.
And he accidentally died.
No, he didn't accidentally die. He was murdered.
Oh,
but he was murdered by just some. You know, it's one of those whole patsy kind of things. You look at it and say, yeah, who hired who for what? Before we go too far down that particular road.
Yeah, we don't.
You were saying you wouldn't sign anything, a petition. Why not? Isn't that an expression of your free speech?
Because free speech is no longer in existence. Obviously, why do you want to put your name on a list? It makes it that much easier for people to look at. I mean, if I was the FBI, that's what I'd do. Just not trying to give you guys any hints, but.
And
I think that's why they came on, was to get people lulled back into sleep and to start speaking out again and start joining militias and rah, rah, rah. I mean, they're bored, probably. There's nothing going on in Fairbanks anymore. Let's go up there and tell them to everything. Why did they feel the need to come up here and clear, quote-unquote, clear their name with the people of Fairbanks? What a joke. They can do whatever they want.
Probably because
they
radio
know
shows
it.
Like this one, they'd call them out. And
well, then they should have came on our radio show. They never called me. They know me. They know Aaron. They could have called us and asked.
They've come to your house, Josh.
Yeah. Uninvited. Wasn't even Thanksgiving.
With guns.
And more than once.
Are you saying that Thanksgiving is open invitation at your house?
No.
Yeah.
Well, bring a turkey, you guys. Well, lots of turkey. We brought like.
Well, if they come, turkeys. They may take a turkey.
They already did. Sorry, Mike. And let's take some calls.
458 talk is the number. Good morning. This is the Saturday morning wake up call. Who's this?
You're all next, and I'm gonna laugh.
You're all next, and he's going to laugh.
You know, that's a typical American response. I'm going to laugh. That was pretty neat when Michael Anderson got arrested, Coleman got arrested, and Lonnie got arrested, his wife, and Coleman's wife. She didn't really get arrested. She was kind of house arrest or whatever, all these things. And people laughed about it. People were on the blogs, on the News Minus, laughing about it, saying, oh, they should have killed them. Those people need to be strung up. Oh, they need to kill them all, blah, blah, blah. Not knowing a thing about what they're talking about. Hooray for the USA, where we laugh and want people that are Americans to be strung up.
458 Talk is the number. Good.
Really brave.
Good morning, caller. Who's this?
Yeah, good morning. Frank Turney here.
Hey, Frank.
And when I think of the FBI, I think of the fathers, brothers, and in-law. They're just like the mafia family. You know, since Micheal Dukes, and you know that's his show, he went to the length to get the FBI and the prosecutor to come on the airway before sentencing. I hope that he would go to the same length to have the defense come on and talk about the case versus just getting media coverage. Don't you agree? And I've talked to one of the defense attorneys that handled the case, and nobody's ever called them to request to come on.
They're welcome to come here. I've told them.
Right. And regarding the stoolies, somebody come in, if you don't report a crime, well, they better arrest me then. But you don't want to, the double standards when the FBI sees one of their own a misconduct, like shooting someone in the back, like an example, they can cover it up for years and years before it's even investigated.
Yeah.
But anyway, I don't wish Shaver Cox any lengthy sentence. I know a lot of people out here like to see him buried, but to me, I think that mild opinion, shaper is something like a buffoon.
Yep.
And I've attended many of his hearings here in Fairbanks, and I told the people around him more than once in the courtroom, you better shut him up or he'll end up in API in a psychiatric ward for some of the things that he said in court. And I've been observing the court for many years, and I've seen many people say less what he said in court end up in API in a 30-day observation tank.
Yeah, he definitely wasn't a friend to himself. I mean, that was ridiculous.
One thing I've always wondered, what happened when the warrant come to arrest Shaver Cox? Did he come out with firing guns and bullets, or did he raise his hand and say, here I am? Or I'd like to know the version of what happened there. I've been hounding the media.
I think he went straight to the ground.
They were in a vehicle together.
No, they're outside of the vehicles. They're over off of, well, I won't even say where they were.
Well,
No, they didn't do anything. They raised their hands immediately, put their hands on their head, and blah, blah, blah. And,
another thing,
I think
one thing about our court system, that we got to have some judicial accountability and the transparency here. This retention vote in these judges is just a joke. We need to get back to, like most states in Oregon, the people elect the judges. The people elect the attorney general and make them accountable to the people, not just the courts and the governor.
Yeah, and we need to vote for a police chief.
That's right.
Didn't believe in voting, John.
That's right.
I don't live in Fairbanks.
Yeah,
giving the people
the
here a good idea.
Thanks for the call, Frank. 458 talk is the number.
These guys were sincere when they came on and talked. We're just pointing out a few obvious things. Like, come on, guys. I don't think you're being totally upfront with what happened. And maybe they're, like I said, maybe they're totally sincere on why they came on. We're just
I've sat with Sutherland more than one time, and he seems like a pretty genuine guy. But all genuineness aside, it's not the way you said it. It's just not.
Right. And you should find a different line of work.
Ready for another call?
Yeah.
458 talk the number. Good morning, caller. Who's this?
Maria.
Maria, what's on your mind?
Well, I was really disappointed by that interview with the federal prosecutor for a number of reasons. And first of all, for Micheal Dukes for having them, and because I thought it was a huge debrief. I thought about the movie Men in Black, where they hold up a flashlight and you forget.
Yeah.
I've already forgotten what you were saying, Maria.
Well, that's why we brought it up today, because we remember.
Well, I hope you do. I was disappointed that Micheal Dukes had those guys on, especially first. And maybe it'll work out. I don't think he'll ever try to have the opposing perspective on. Most likely he won't, because he seems to take the side of the establishment and the state in a lot of things. And the second reason I was disappointed is because I heard all of his audience buy it. You know, the next day they called, and that day they called, and they said, boy, I'm glad you had these guys. This clears the air on some things. Well, no, it doesn't.
Yeah, it didn't clear anything. I know Hillbilly, he called in the very next day, and he didn't buy it.
No, and the smart people don't, and the people that are strong don't. I missed that part, and unfortunately I've been busy, and I've missed a lot of the, you know, your shows and what's been going on in town, but...
Well, that's where you're wrong, Maria. You should make this a priority. You need to set your alarm and make sure that you're listening to the Saturday morning wake-up call.
Bill does, so you've got one. But anyway, it was a huge debrief, and Frank's exactly right. You know, they need to have the opposing perspective, and it's Micheal Dukes' show. He'll decide to do what he wants to do. But the people in the town, you know, they removed the trial to Anchorage, and you're exactly right. It was a huge violation. That should have happened here. Then they had the audacity, after a full year of reporting that it was a militia trial, every single day in the paper, militia, militia, militia,
yep.
They had the audacity to come here and say, had nothing to do with the militia. Well, in that case, they weren't lying. The very first headline that came up in the Fairbanks News Minor... Well, when the FBI came and surrounded those five places, And the headline was 5 inches high. It said raid. And the sub-headline said, FBI cracks down on sovereignty movement. And that headline was up for 20 minutes. And then it was gone. And after that, it was, from then on, it was militia.
At the same time, you had national papers writing on it saying the FBI nationwide was cracking down on sovereignty movements.
Yeah, and the prosecutors thank the local media for getting it right.
At what point? Sovereignty or militia? Probably militia.
Well, he didn't really say. He just said he thought the media did a great job, and he thanked them for getting it right. So that kind of contradicted what he said for the next 2 hours. But what do you expect?
Right.
And the people that were calling in, thanking, so glad to clear it up, you know, those are the same people that are, those are the same mentality of people that are in New York City right now and New Jersey when Sandy was coming through, and they're dependent on the government to take care of them, and now they're all a bunch of freakazoids. We talked about it last week where, you know, everyone was saying about how the people in, with Katrina, you know, well, we expect them to act like a bunch of freaks down there because they're black and they're poor.
Oh, right, sure.
And then we read an article last week about a gal that lives, or a guy, I don't, someone that lived in the uppity side of town in New Jersey, and he was saying how everyone there, you know, good cars, good families, nice people, were freaking out and acting like a bunch of psychopaths because the state wasn't there taking care of them. And they were chasing each other around with baseball bats because they were starving. They didn't have any food. They didn't have any water. They didn't have any gas. Those are the same kind of people that call up and say, I really thank the FBI for coming in here and clearing things up for me, because my belief and love of the state was shaken there for a while, but you know,
I'm right back
better.
To where I was
exactly.
before. Yeah.
You're
yeah.
next, Josh, and we're all going to laugh.
And let me make one other point. They didn't go to KUAC and debrief that audience, and they didn't go to Kayak FM and debrief that audience. They were very targeted in who they were debriefing.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
They went
There's
to one show.
There's a reason why they went to Mike's show.
That's right. So,
and I'm not upset that he had it. Well, I was at first because I wouldn't really give him the time of day, even though, well, maybe I would.
Yeah,
It'd be fun to cross-examine him a little bit.
I would have a debate with him a little bit more.
Pull
than
out my interrogation skill.
No,
hey,
no.
Can I ask you, all three of you here, Maria on the phone, and of course, Josh and Aaron, do you lie regularly to people, Aaron?
Every time I come
only
on
when
show.
I'm on the show.
Okay. Now, Maria, do you lie regularly to people?
Only when she calls
well,
me.
Well, if I say no, okay, no.
Okay, well, let me ask you this here. What do you think of somebody who's willing to lie as a regular basis a part of their life? Because that's what the FBI does when they've got informants. When you've got somebody working undercover, you are encouraging that person to lie in order to find out what kind of plots might be going on. At what point can you trust what's coming out of his mouth?
Never.
Okay, so that means when he's coming on the radio, is he lying then?
That's right. That's exactly
right. Do you know when he's lying, or do you know what is
yeah,
the truth?
When he's talking.
Well, his job is to be a liar. That's the point you made. And the other thing that you've got a federal prosecutor who doesn't understand how the Constitution works. And
yeah.
I love Treal to come in and say, look, do you even know Marbury versus Madison? Do you even understand why the founders, or why that, you know, at that point in history, I don't know exactly what the year was, but it was later on. You know, why do we say if a law is in opposition to the Constitution, why do we say it's a bad law? Because the Constitution was meant to stand regardless of political law, regardless of how we, you know, somebody that we elect happens to change it. Doesn't matter.
Right. That's the whole point of the Bill of Rights. The Bill of Rights are not laws that were instituted into the Constitution. The Bill of Rights, the original 10, or the original 6 or 7, and then you look at 9, it says, just because we put these in, number 9 says, all of your common law rights are yours at all time. No way, matter, shape, or form can this Congress or any people violate those rights.
It's God's law.
Exactly.
Yep. Okay.
Thanks for the call, Maria. Mm-hmm. All right, we've got about 2.5 minutes left here. What do you want to do, Josh? 458 Talk is the number. Good morning. This is the Far North Tentacles Saturday Morning Wake-Up Call. Who's this?
Morning. This is the founder of Charity Wheels. How are you doing this morning?
Okay, Kevin, I'd ask you to take a couple of weeks off the air, so I'm going to move on. Good morning, caller. Who's this?
This is Randy.
Randy, go ahead.
Well, hi there. I have to say that I very appreciate Micheal Dukes having those that FBI guy on and the special prosecutor, mainly, ultimately, because I think it should help Schaefer Cox. It brings the issue back before the public, and we need to write more letters to the judge asking for leniency for Schaefer Cox. It also gave a chance for some people to call in, like Josh, to have counterpoints. And so it also, and I also agree with Frank that they should now have the attorney for Schaefer Cox to come on. And one other thing I wanted to touch on, what Hillbilly said early on in the show about, you know, if you talk to somebody who's planning to commit a crime and you don't report it, you know, you're guilty of a felony or something yourself, that's kind of a scary thought. It may be the case, in fact, but I think people should never be afraid. If someone starts murmuring about some weird stuff, people should go out of their way. I've always had this feeling they should talk to that person. We need to talk to each other, and if a person's just in the beginning stages of talking about something weird, that's not a crime. That's just murmuring about something, and that's the time to cut things off in the bud.
I agree with you, Randy, and thank you for making that point. We should have... Well, I know people went to Schaefer Cox and talked to him, but why didn't the FBI just go and have a visit with him and say, hey, man, you need to cool your jets? I don't know. I guess that's not as fun.
All right, we are out of time today.
Yeah, this is only 1 hour
today. It's only 1 hour today because up next we've got the on-air auction, but we will be back next week at 9 a.m. right here on KFAR.
Thanks.
Local Talk Radio. Real quick, the contact information, Josh.
PatriotsLament@gmail.com. PatriotsLament.blogspot.com is the website, and Radio Free...